So we have a video happening right now. Hi, night class. What up?
What's up? My name's Levi. Follow me on Instagram. I'm just kidding.
Not the time for you to be upping your Insta followers. Or whatever they are. Okay. So we just finished hiding. It likes to hide. We are now in chapter 19, vocal music in the classical period. So I said at the beginning of the classical period that I really, really enjoy it because it's where my voice type really starts to get music to perform. I hate the Baroque period music for singers. I like to listen to it. I don't like to sing it. Classical period is where I feel that the vocal repertoire gets very, very, very enjoyable. So opera, if you recall, I told you the story about one of the Handelian operas. Yes, sir. I do not. Does someone have an extra writing implement? Over here. Oh, yes. So, good talk. So, during one of Handel's operas, there was a full-blown fist fight, and the two sopranos on stage pulled hair and all of that wonderful business. This led to the downfall of Baroque opera all across Europe. People started despising it. You've all seen parodies on, I don't know, Harry Potter and the Lord of the Rings and all that stuff, parody videos on Princess Bride. We've all seen them, they're hysterical. Well, people started despising opera so much that they just started doing all these parodies, spoof operas to make fun of the composers. And because of it, the public mindset for opera was that this is so dumb. We're not gonna go watch that. It began killing Baroque opera. The overriding annoyance with opera as unrealistic and useless nearly killed musical theater altogether. Bring in the saviors of opera, the reform opera. The reform opera is the type of opera it is. It's also a genre of opera. During the Enlightenment period, they brought in certain reforms to clean up opera and make it more accessible to a general public. The overture, the music that's played before the opera starts, it was used to in the Baroque period, was written and people would just walk in and chit-chat over it, kind of like y'all do over me when I'm at the beginning of the class. You just chit-chat over me. I don't like that. Neither did the composers. They didn't like it that you were talking over their music. So now the overture set the scene. Curtain rises and the overture's playing and everybody's like, ooh, this sounds like it's gonna be a happy opera, yay. Or, oh no, we accidentally came to a drama. Oh, everybody's gonna die. So the music set the scene, set the stage. And if you weren't in your seat in time for the orchestra, you didn't get to go to your seat at all. You lost your money.
Not even at the intermission.
They have rules. today it's different. If you can come in as soon as there's a clapping, as soon as the audience goes, yay, you can walk in. Classical restraint was imposed on acting and writing to make music, dialogue, and behaviors more natural. So remember the Enlightenment period, much more rational thoughts, rational ideas. They wanted acting to demonstrate the new rationality that the entire continent was starting to use in their own behaviors. So everything in the Baroque period was like, oh no, she died, is now, my heart, she died. Still unnatural to us, but much closer to it than, oh. They wanted wording and movement and acting to mimic more realistic, more life things. Also, members of the ballet and chorus during the Baroque opera, like, there'd be all this action happening, yay, 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 and only the main characters would be on stage. And then all of a sudden, just out of nowhere, would pop a full chorus of people in regular clothes. And you'd just be like, whoa. Broke the scene. Where'd these people come from? And ballet would come on just randomly. It had nothing to do either musically or visually with anything. It'd just be like, the curtain went down, on comes a ballet dancer. Whoop. I didn't dance ballet. I wasn't allowed. and the audience would be like, whoa, the dancers are here. Why? Now, in the Reform Opera, the dancers are in full costume. They're part of the story. If it's a story about shepherds, the dancers are in shepherd and shepherdess costume, and they little sheep come on stage and stuff. If the if it's about, I don't know, gods and goddesses, the chorus will come on dressed as regular Greek folk, or maybe as a troupe of gods and goddesses. So they look like they belong, and their music belongs. The difference between aria, you know, the song, and the recit, remember I defined recit as this moves the action along, and the aria is us standing still on an emotion and talking about how we feel. They now become, the difference between the two is much smaller, and they flow more cleanly. So instead of it being like, princess, the queen wants you, come inside, and then one and then the other, they sound like super disjointed. It's dear princess, come inside, your mother wants you. Sorry, translating in English for a recit is a lot easier. It's just easier to sing the other one in Italian, so you get both of them. But the music flows much better and it sounds cleaner, sliding from one to the other, as opposed to words, song, words, song. So that is basic ideas of Reform Opera. Reform Opera also brought in the comic opera. Comic does not mean funny. It means happy. It just means happy. Like with a Shakespearean play, a comedy doesn't mean that it's necessarily funny, it just means that it ends better. It ends on a lighter note. A comic opera is shorter. It deals with everyday life, normally with the common folk. It ends happily on a lighter tone, and it's always in the common language of the country it's performed in. So if they were writing a comic opera in Germany, it would be in German. In French, in France, it'd be in French, so on and so forth. And a lot of times they would translate the operas from one country to the next so that it's easier and better accessible for the average citizen to go to. Comic operas were easily related to by the average citizen because they were about the average citizen. They weren't always about nobility. Or they would be like somebody going from rags to riches. Opera buffa. Buffa is the, buff is the root word for buffoon. So opera buffa, funny, slapstick, is like Groucho Marx and Laurel and Hardy meets Mr. Bean, and I know these are all really old comics, sorry. And I don't know, Jimmy Fallon, all rolled into one, singing songs. Opera buffa, buffoon, buffoonery, it's funny. The bass voice started taking a huge dominant role during opera buffa. The bass voice became a large artistic and very comic contributor. In the Baroque period, it was the soprano, the countertenor, you know, the guy who sings like a soprano, and the mezzo-soprano all playing the lead roles. Now, the bass steps forward and becomes a thing. He's typically super, super funny. He plays one of two parts. He either plays the super funny bad guy that we all can poke fun at, or he plays the super funny idiot that we all can poke fun at. Usually, he's funny. case in point, the Marriage of Figaro. In Figaro, the main character, Figaro, is a baritone, not a bass. The bad guy is the bass. And he's the character we all make fun of. People are like, hey, look what we did to this guy. He's so dumb. And then in Cenerentola, that's Italian for Cinderella. The base is two, there are two different people, actually there are three different bases. Hey, one is a very serious guy. We don't count him. The other one is Dundini. He is the, he's just dumb. And everybody's like, you're dumb, ha ha ha. And then there's the dad. Instead of having a wicked stepmother, there's a wicked stepfather. And he is a base, and he, everybody's just like, oh my gosh, please go away. Please go away. He's that kind of guy. Then the Reform Opera also brought the ensemble finale. So instead of just like the chorus getting on and the, singing the big finale, all singing the exact same thing, now we have a closing section in which several soloists, say the soprano, the tenor, the bass, and the contralto, all and the mezzo-soprano, all get together and sing their own words, music, and rhythm to close the act. So let's say, I don't know, soprano gets on and she sings her main love thing, and the mezzo gets on and she sings her I wish I was you thing, and the tenor goes on, I'm in love with you, and we all sing the different parts all on top of each other. It's used in all forms of opera and musical theater to this day. A great example is this. Yay! It is Les Mis, the first act finale for Les Miserables. If you watched, is it Hugh Jackman? If you watched Hugh Jackman before you saw, have before you're gonna see this, I feel bad for you, son, because this is the better one. Because Hugh Jackman has lost his ability.
One day more.
So here's
another
the tenor.
Day, another destiny.
Laying down his thing.
This never-ending road to Calvary. These men who seem to know my crime will surely come a second time. One day more.
Joe Jonas laying down his thing. He's the only mistake.
One day more.
We'll be ready for these good boys. They'll wet themselves, they will. Thomas should not have been. He, if you watch the whole show with him, he makes the same face each time. Oh no. Oh no. Oh no. Joe Jonas. Poor guy. He was out of his depth. That's an opera house. Look, it's so fancy. Woo! Make sure I didn't pass anything. Okay, so Mozart's operas. Mozart wrote tons and tons of opera. He was quite famous for his ability to capture the human voice's beauty. The Magic Flute is probably one of his most famous operas because it's super accessible for children. It's often used to introduce the art form to kids. My nephew is 2 years old and he absolutely loves this particular version of this song. I mean, he always asks for it. Then you're not my kid anymore and I'll kill you. Whoa. Guess which one of the parents is actually the bad one? It's her. So, it is a comic opera. There are some funny characters in it, but it's a comic opera. It's not a comedy. So Don Giovanni is what would be termed neither comic nor buffa. It is Italian opera seria, or serious opera. It has serious themes. It's very dramatic. It's about a womanizer, Don Giovanni, getting his comeuppance, and I think he ends up going to hell. Hey, comeuppance. The Marriage of Figaro is an opera buffa, or a funny opera, in which Mozart always had like some sort of womanizing jerk in his operas. He always wrote them in. They usually got what they deserved, though, so may that be a lesson for you. In The Marriage of Figaro, the count, or the man in power, is the womanizer. He is married, and this is like the second in a trilogy of Mozart operas. It's the second one, so the first one, it's the count pursuing the woman he wants and getting her. And the second one, it's about him pursuing somebody else and his wife being like, what can I do to teach him a lesson? And so she gets her head together with the woman that's being chased and also with that woman's future husband, and they teach the count a lesson he'll never forget, and he apologizes. Yeah. Woo! The pants roll. So the pants roll is a classical era invention. The mezzo-soprano is playing a male youth role. So you're not likely to find too many young men between the ages of 14 and 18 on stage singing major operatic roles, just because it's very, very, singing on stage is very, very hard on the voice, and a mature voice is what's needed in order to maintain that level of singing at all times. I could go into all of the science behind it, But suffice it to say that nobody should be performing on stage, night class, until they're about 21 or 22. Okay, moving on. So let's listen to a little bit of The Marriage of Figaro. We'll skip to right about here, where Figaro and his fiancée Susanna are singing about how happy they are to have their new apartment. Figaro is measuring the apartment's dimensions. You'll hear some Italian numbers at the beginning. And Susanna is looking at her wedding trousseau. If I can get to that. Don't freeze on me. Oh, please don't do this. Every time. Oh, no. The thinking thing of death. Hey, it's not responding. Fantastic. Yeah, shut up. It's still not responding. Access denied. Whoa. I see how it is. We'll skip listening to that. How about that? Uh-oh. Oh, no. Program. Yay! Open program. See, it didn't do this for the other class. The other class got all the way through without an issue. It's just you guys. It's your fault. Okay. So we're going to skip listening to that. This is a scene from The Marriage of Figaro where the Countess is figuring out her strategy for teaching her horrible husband a lesson. So besides opera, there were also oratorios written during the classical period. This is a staging of Haydn's Creation. There is the chorus and the ensemble and soloist, and here's all of the prince's visitors. Yay. So the antique style, first practice, style antico, was still heavily used in the classical period. It's a holdover from Baroque. And technically, if you go to some very, very, very conservative Catholic churches, you are likely to still hear music from this time period played. Bel canto, or beautiful voice, this is Italian for beautiful voice, bel meaning beauty, and canto meaning voice, is a style of singing used for much of the classical period and beyond. It is a typical operatic style that most of us equate with opera. It's free vibrato, full breath. So the Baroque period, you're likely to hear a lot of singers sing like this. Straight tone. Classical period, the bel canto is. Notice how there's a huge difference. Besides there being vibrato, it's fuller, right? It takes up the space. Big difference. Resonance. So oratorios, in the classical period, there weren't so many. There were still sacred oratorio, biblical stories, but there also started to be secular oratorios about just random subjects. The creation is about the creation of the world, so it's biblical and it's source material. But the seasons is about the four seasons, winter, spring, summer, and fall. And it has no source material from the Bible. It's just Haydn having himself a good time, like, LOL, I can do whatever I want. Ha, ha, ha. That's pretty much it. A requiem. We talked about the different parts of a mass. Well, a requiem is a funerary mass. Mozart composed one, but he did not complete it. This is what he wanted played at his funeral. They didn't have enough money to pay for another composer to complete his work, and they didn't have enough money to pay for musicians to play his work. So he didn't get nothing. But the Dies Irae is the most famous movement. I'm sure you all will recognize it. Judgment. May the rocks fall on us to hide us from the wrath of the Lord. So it sounds like you hear the timpani command, that's rocks. The choir is written to sound like the wrath of God. That sounds like the fires of hell coming up to burn the earth and all of that stuff. The source material for this movement of the mass is taken directly from Revelation. So if you went to, let's say you go to an opera buffa like The Marriage of Figaro, would you rather see it in its original form in the German with the titles, the translations over top of the stage, or would you rather see it in English?
German.
In English.
German, English. There is no wrong answer. It's opera buffa. Did you say Latin?
Italian.
Italian, okay. Oh, is it Italian? LOL. Whatever, the original language. Ha ha ha. Whatever. There are some purists like me who'd rather go see it in its original language in the Italian. But there are also great arguments for seeing it in the English. Namely that opera buffa was originally intended for audiences to see it in their native tongue. But on the other side of the coin, the lyrics aren't going to sound as good unless they are the original. They won't match well with the music. So there's that as well. Should theater music, I'm gonna rephrase this to make it make a little more sense. Should I write lyrics first and then compose music with them? Or should I write the music first and then write the lyrics? Lyrics first,
music
first. Both are correct. Remember, this is the two sides of the coin. For me, I write the lyrics first because I think that the words are more important. Other composers write the music first because they say, oh, I can always come up with words that sound nice to it. No matter which side of the argument you're on, 3 billion people are going to agree with you because it's split smack down the middle on, you know, the population thinking one is right and one is wrong. It's time to play. Which old dead guy served a prince?
Haydn.
Haydn, yeah. Haydn's a member of this class. He's not this guy. Which old dead guy had a prodigy sister?
Mozart.
Boom. Who wrote musical jokes?
Haydn.
LOL. Who wrote in the Empfindsamstille?
Mozart?
Nope.
It's good.
It does start with a C. It's C P E Bach.
Oh.
There are two different terms for this: Empfindsamstille and German sensitive style. Empfindsam is German, so you need to choose a German composer. I mean, doesn't he look just like his daddy? Which old dead guy was bad with relationships?
Mozart.
No, Haydn was good with relationships. Which old dead guy was nice to everyone and good with people?
Haydn.
Who wrote in the Rococo style?
It starts with a C. C-O-U-P-E,
something like that. Yes, Couperin. C-O-U-P-E-R-I-N, Couperin. Which old dead guy was a classical composer? All of the above.
Okay.
Woo! Okay. Trick question. All right, let's move on to number 14. Beethoven. So we'll just do this way because I don't want us to have to shut things down. Beethoven, as some of you may know, is very, very famous for his symphonies. So famous that he got a Fantasia segment. That is the ultimate in fame right there. Look at the little horse. Little Pegasus. This is from his pastoral symphony. All of his symphonies have nicknames, pastoral, eroica, things like that, to demonstrate what they make people think about or Beethoven's original intent. That one is pastoral, so it's nature. Therefore, I mean, of course, there aren't real winged horses, but Disney does what it wants. So Beethoven, Ludwig von Beethoven, it's not Beethoven, it's not Beethoven, it's Beethoven, double letters in German elongate the sound, 1770 to 1827. He was a musical revolutionary in every sense of the word. He took the classical music that Haydn perfected and Mozart built upon, and he turned it on its head and gave it this undercurrent of stormy passion. He's considered a transitional composer, as in he composed both classical and romantic, the next genre, he facilitated the change into the next genre. The fact is, he is a classical composer. He was born and he lived during the classical period. Some of his musical style overlaps with the next time period. His family was very musical. His dad was a musician, but they didn't give him the musical education that Mozart got from his dad. They thought he might be a prodigy, but he wasn't. His dad really pushed him. Like, Mozart's dad was strict, Beethoven's dad was abusive. And he really, really pushed Beethoven. But the fact was, Beethoven was just very, very talented for his age. I said that a prodigy is a child who can contribute creatively. Beethoven is very creative, he's a genius. But his genius didn't manifest itself at a young age, it manifested itself in his adulthood. He did meet Mozart, and he wanted to learn from Mozart. Mozart was older than him. But by the time Beethoven was old enough to move to Vienna and to study with Mozart, Mozart had died. Sad, but true. But Beethoven's music would have been very, very, very different if he had studied with Mozart. So let's all be like, I'm sorry Mozart's dead, but I'm glad Beethoven's music is the way it is, because it's awesome. He studied with Haydn instead. So Haydn got along with everybody except for with Beethoven. So they had like completely opposite dispositions. Haydn was like, troll, lol, let's have a good time. I like you, you're so talented. And Beethoven was like, leave me alone, old man. I hate you, I hate life. Mozart's dead. Why can't you be? They didn't get along. Beethoven was an emo, like severe. He made money as a piano instructor to aristocrats as an adult. He had affairs with some of the women that he tutored. He mainly tutored women, because like I said, music was a woman's way to show off. And he He was a major hit with the ladies. He was in serious relationships with at least 6 women, and he had several girlfriends on the side. He was the musical Casanova. He was just all over the place. A contemporary said that Beethoven was forever in love relationships that would have been difficult for many an Adonis. So basically, not even Adonis could handle Beethoven's mad game. Fur Elise was dedicated to one of his many conquests. Let's adjust that. Fur Elise was dead. The final dedication is to one of his final conquests. This was Beethoven. This is what he did. He's such a jerk. This was his way of getting pretty much any woman he wanted. Hey, baby, it's time for your lesson. You want to hear my new composition? I wrote it for you. For real, he'd just take it. Für means four. And he'd put for Elizabeth, for Elise, for Greta. The last woman was Elise. Hey, baby. So, women love a creative guy. What can I say? He's one of those ones that I guess he was considered very, very handsome for the time period. I don't see it, but what can you say? Got mad game. Mad game. This is him in his 20s. Maybe that was it. But the fact is, he had girlfriends from age 12 all the way through his death at 57. And his real mad game didn't start until he was in his mid to late 30s and lasted all the way up until his death. Just like, whoa. He composed with great difficulty. He was a genius, but he wasn't a whiz kid like Mozart or Haydn. Mozart and Haydn could crank something out, lickety split. Mozart is known for famously composing the overture for one of his operas the day of the opera, because he forgot to do it before. He was like, oh, oops, LOL, play this. And they're like, oh, okay. Haydn was known for doing that type of thing too. But Beethoven couldn't do that. He composed very carefully, very methodically. The curse of the prodigy like Mozart or Amadeus Deutscher is that the hard, dedicated worker catches up to him eventually. Eventually, the ability levels even out. So the prodigy manifests their brilliance and a adult-like capability at a very young age, whereas the average person has to work up to that over a period of years. But in the 20s, in like 20 to 30, everything evens out. While the genius level may be higher for the prodigy still, the ability level of what can be put out evens out. Everything evens out. My dad told me that when I was little. I was like, I'm going to be Shirley Temple. And he's like, no, you're not. I'm like, oh, okay. He goes, eventually, just you'll be a really tall tap dancer. I wasn't allowed to tap dance, guys. So Mozart died very early at 35, but regardless of his intelligence and his ability level, he had a very unsteady work ethic. He composed whenever he needed money, pretty much, or he composed whenever the feeling struck him. Beethoven lived for 57 full years. He started composing when he was a teenager, and he spent more than 30 of those years slowly working away at his compositions. So while Mozart wrote dozens of works to a single Beethoven song, all of Beethoven's compositions are considered masterpieces, while only the best of Mozart is considered masterful. When you crank out piece after piece after piece, or as a writer, you write story after story after story, not all of them are going to be the best that you've ever done. Just like if you play baseball, not every swing is a home run. Or if you are the pitcher, not every throw is a strike. That's just the way it is. But if you're super methodical, you like how I brought that in? If you're super methodical and you're really careful, everything you do can be at the top of your game. There are certain things Beethoven I don't consider very good. That may sound super stuck up of me, but I've sung his music. His music is not written well for singers. Mozart's, however, is. But then again, there are things that Beethoven excels at that Mozart doesn't. So just everything in balance. Beethoven wrote 9 symphonies. He composed over 3 major periods of his life. So his first period of composition included symphonies 1 and 2. Symphonies 3 through 8 came in period number 2, and symphony 9, his final symphony, was in his third period. These periods also encompass all of his works. So the really, I guess you could say, naive, really bubbly stuff is in period number 1, when his early compositions. His composing from like 29 up and through his late 40s is symphonies number 3 through 8. We would consider this the time when most Americans are having their midlife crisis. Beethoven is cranking out work after work after work. When, as an artist, you reach this kind of, you reach full adulthood, you get to this place where you're really, you know what you're doing, you know how to write, you know how to produce what you want, and your best art comes out at that time. Whereas towards the end of your life, his 9th symphony, let's say, the 9th symphony is the culmination of all of his experience in life, in art, in music, in composition. Everything that he knows went into the 9th symphony. So he had way less symphonies at the end of his life than he did in the middle of his life, but his 9th symphony is his masterwork. It is his greatest masterpiece. I don't know what this is. Let's exit out of this before I press something I'm going to regret. Oh yeah! This is one of his piano works, and the Koreans did it awesome.
Now. There's three people who say wow a lot. Like, I don't hear anybody else in the world say wow like they do.
Well, I mean, it's awesome. Beethoven. Beethoven highly respected Napoleon Bonaparte. When Napoleon came to power just after ending the French Revolution, he promised equity and, you know, all of the Enlightenment goodness to the people of France. Beethoven saw Napoleon as kind of like everything. Beethoven wrote Symphony No. 3, the Eroica, also in English it's the Heroic Symphony, in Napoleon's honor. Napoleon's whole thing was, if you elect me, vote for me, I'll make sure that the aristocrats can't beat you up anymore. And then he proceeded to beat everybody up. So, however, Napoleon began conquering other nations and insisting on the inferiority of the non-French. He was a racial supremacist. Beethoven retracted the dedication of the Heroic Symphony completely. The ideals of the Enlightenment is that, one of the ideals of the Enlightenment was, we're all equal, but our nations are all separate. And that's one of the things that make us so equal, that we all have our separate identities. Napoleon said, everybody should be French, and if you're from a different country, you're inferior to me. So Beethoven was like, whoa. When Napoleon started going out to conquer, Beethoven really lost a lot of his respect, not just for Napoleon, but his respect for humanity as a whole. He wrote an opera called Fidelio, his only opera. Bach wrote no operas, but Beethoven wrote one opera. Fidelio is his only opera, and it was written as a denunciation of Napoleon's actions and as a restatement of Beethoven's belief in the common brotherhood of mankind. Beethoven, up until this point, emo fellow that he was, you know, super emo, he believed in the common goodness of man. Napoleon killed that. So he lost his ideals of everybody's good, which kind of not, but he did say, I believe that everybody, that we all should be brothers and sisters and equal. Fidelio is a political opera directly denouncing the Napoleonic authority in France. It's about a political prisoner who has been slated for death. His wife dresses as a man and gets work in the dungeon that he is being kept in, and eventually is able to free him. And, you know, the Enlightenment triumphs overall. Yay! It is considered one of the hardest operas in the repertoire to perform because Beethoven really wasn't good at composing for singers. It's really hard to sing. He began going deaf in his 20s due to an ear illness. Near the end of his career, he was composing completely by what he could hear in his own head, and he was completely and totally deaf. So, take this into consideration. He's so much of a genius that he can remember all of the instrumental parts and compose just by imagining them. And everything after he went deaf was stunning. That would be all of his symphonies 3 through 9. He considered suicide shortly after the initial onset of his deafness. People had to communicate with him via pen and paper. Very, very frustrating for him. He already had a bad temper. Can you just imagine the poor people going in and trying to, you know, take his lunch order? Those poor waiters and waitresses. Had the worst day ever. Oh no, Beethoven's back. His deafness affected his personality. He was already emo. This made him even crankier, even more cross when, you know, can't imagine being one of his girlfriends. At his final public conducting appearance, he was still conducting a few beats after the orchestra had completed the last note. So, and a conductor's back is to the audience, like so. The orchestra is spanned out in front of me. I'm conducting. The orchestra has stopped, and I'm still conducting. Makes me look kind of dumb, right? So, nobody knew until that moment that he was deaf. His music was so good that they did not know that he was deaf. I mean, it's kind of a sad story, beautiful regardless, but still sad. He never went out and performed in public again after that because he was so embarrassed. But the public's general thought was, how does he write this music if he can't hear a note? He died of lead poisoning. Lead was used for the pipes and the plumbing. It was also used in wine bottles. I think they around the cork to seal the cork off. It may have led to the illness that caused his deafness. We can't be sure, but it most certainly killed him. In the 20th century, there is a preserved lock of his hair at his home. I've seen it. It's gross. It's gross. They took one of his hair strands and took it in for DNA testing. It is filled with lead. Hit all of his hair. Just so his lead poisoning was so advanced that even his hair had lead all the way laced through it. Well, of course he died. Lead poisoning. Ooh. And his hair isn't very pretty. It's all gray and nasty. Just FYI. His approach to form. So we've talked about the rondo form, A, B, A, C, A. We've talked about the minuet and trio form, A, B, A. And we've talked about the sonata allegro form, A, B, A prime. Altered forms. He liked to alter things because he's Beethoven and he can do what he wants. He worked hard enough. So the scherzo. The scherzo means joke. It's a faster, lighter piece. Unlike Haydn, who actually wrote real jokes into his pieces, Beethoven just considered a fast, light piece funny. So it's his joke piece. Scherzo means joke. He used the approaches of Mozart and Haydn, but he changed things according to his own needs. So this is where we kind of get into the romantic period. Romantic composers change things willy-nilly. Yeah, I know the rules, I can do whatever I want. Beethoven knew the rules, he did whatever the heck he wanted. He would change portions of Sonata Allegro, A, B, A prime, by making the transitions between sections seamless. So instead of being able to hear, you know, here's the end, oh, now we're moving into the next one. It's, where'd the end of that first section go? I can't, whoa, okay, we're moving on. That's Beethoven. He always had a coda, and usually lengthened the coda so much that it was its own movement. So a Mozart or Haydn coda might be a minute and a half to 2 minutes long. A Beethoven coda could last 10 minutes long. Therefore, it's its own movement. They're huge, just huge. I don't like playing Beethoven. He combined forms, so he would like combine the sonata allegro form with the trio and minuet form and just, you know, do whatever. YOLO, Beethoven. Piano sonata number 8, the Pathétique, and number 5 in C minor. I'm just gonna open these because open half a link. Ooh, Fantasia. So this is the C minor. Ooh, we all recognize this. Probably one of his most famous openings for a symphony.
Thank you.
Oh, look, that's so 2000. I think he wrote this after a breakup, if I'm not mistaken. They're just newly together. There was an 80s movie called Immortal Beloved based on who historians thought was his main squeeze. He wrote a series of letters and addressed them to the Immortal Beloved. And one woman actually, remember I told you that Mozart's wife made an empire off of his death? This woman, like two or three women claimed to be the Immortal Beloved, but one woman had more support during her lifetime, and she made tons of money claiming to be Beethoven's Immortal Beloved after he died when he couldn't, you know, refute the claims. Sneaky. So really, the Immortal Beloved and the Mozart movie from the 80s, don't trust them. Nobody knows. So, yes, I feel like there's something else I'm leaving out. Oh, no, nothing more than Beethoven was the classical Taylor Swift. He wrote a breakup song for every girl. And every girl still, unlike Taylor Swift, every girl that he dated still wanted to be with him. Oh. Okay, so take out a piece of paper.